All right, good evening again. It's 6 o'clock by my watch, and we do have a quorum of the board present. So I'm going to go ahead and call the meeting to order at 6 p.m. It's the meeting of the Bennington Board of Education. This meeting is conducted, as always, under the provisions of the Nebraska Open Meetings Act, which is posted in the back of the room. And we always start our meeting with public forum. Is there anybody who would like to address the board in public forum this evening? Hearing no one interested in addressing the board this evening, we will proceed then with our agenda, beginning with the consent agenda, which includes the approval of minutes from our last regular meeting is on March 14, as well as our special meeting on March 28, along with bills, resignations, and hires. Allison, did you have notes from bill review?
Yes, Karen, I had bill review. Two items of note: increased costs on buses. As you all know, we're short on buses, or bus drivers, excuse me. So that was one additional cost, and then some additional trips that were needed with the activities, I believe.
Yes.
And then additional fuel costs. We're seeing those increases like everybody, I think, is. So two items of note. Karen, did you have anything else to add? Okay.
Thank you. With that, I'd entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
Thank you, Karen. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Allison. Jody, please call the roll.
Valerie?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
Kara?
Yes.
The consent agenda is approved. Now we'll proceed to our reports, beginning with administrator reports, and always start with Helen Edry. Would remind the presenters for the benefit of the audience to tell us who you are, and then we'll listen with interest to your report.
Good evening, Allison Evangelisti, principal at Pine Creek. We have updated numbers, including incoming kindergarten, and then just wanted to highlight that we've got to bring back our cross grade level homerooms that are made differently at each building. But it's been really wonderful starting in January to bring back the camp time rather brigades and see the classes work together. Kindergarten through fifth grade on problem solving and social skills. It's truly a highlight of our early out days. So any questions?
Thank you. And now the middle school report.
Good evening. My name is Sean Hoppus. I'm the middle school principal. Just a couple items of note. We just finished up our state testing last week, so it went really well in our building. We tried a little bit of a different schedule, which I think kids appreciated. We just tested in their math and reading classrooms instead of an altered schedule, so it kept a little better flow, and I think the kids appreciated that. And then as you can see, we are working on those transitions already. So we're getting prepared for the fifth to sixth transition, have meetings set up with kids. They'll be coming up to the middle school May 10 and 11. We'll have some parent nights for fifth grade parents. And then for the Bennington South one, we're gonna try to have some video and pictures so those parents can see what the building will look like. So any questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hoppus. And now high school report.
I'm Matt Blumenkamp, High School Principal. Okay, we will be hosting our annual Bennington Invitational Track Meet here on the 19th when we return back from spring break. That'll be Tuesday the 19th, with a 1:30 start at the stadium at the school. We also will host the EMC track meet this year as well, which is Tuesday, May 3rd. And with the rain out date being Wednesday, the 4th, which is an early out for us at Bennington Public Schools. But we will be hosting two invitational track meets. We did host a JV invite a week ago as well. So this is the year of track for us in the spring. Mr. Kessel's getting very good at running track meets. But that's an event that requires a lot of people to run smoothly, a lot of teachers, a lot of volunteers, administrators come give us a hand as well. So we had a good event last Tuesday and look forward to hosting the next two over the course of the next 2 or 3 weeks. Questions?
Thank you. Thank you. Student services.
I'm Whitney Fagan, Director of Student Services. So this first part I shared with you is just some growth numbers we shared in our Cognia review last week that I thought you guys might like to see over the last 5 years and all of the departments I get to work with. And the second part is this is kind of the year or spring time of the year that we do a lot of state reporting for student services, and we had our ESSA visit for Title I monitoring this last month, and I just wanted to say they had great things to say about our school board and give you guys a lot of congratulations towards having math and reading services being part of our title funding, which isn't typical in a lot of school districts. So thank you. Any questions?
Curriculum, instruction, and assessment.
Well, there's some of each of that in my report. DHOE Assistant Superintendent. So to start out, we have assessment, and you've heard from the buildings what's been going on during state testing tonight. Curriculum, we have lots of committees working right now to finish up their work in different areas for adoption. At the bottom of page one, you'll see our enrollments for summer school for K-8. We wait a little longer on the high school as that really is a credit recovery program. And so our numbers are dependent on how kids do in that second semester on courses. So overall, we started with a list of 600 kids recommended, the parents we talked to at conferences, and we'll be serving right about 300 students in our K-8 program this summer. And then on the back page on school improvement, as was already mentioned, we did have our Cognia district accreditation visit this past week. And many kudos go out to the students who got interviewed during that, parents who were interviewed during that time, board members as well, teachers. The committee visited with over 100 people during their 4 days with the district and had lots of complimentary things to talk about within our district. They gave us two areas of high compliments and commendations. They were that we had a collaborative culture that really prioritized students and student growth. And then the second area is really involving our stakeholders. We have lots of evidence of involving our stakeholders while we're planning a future high school with committee members, all our strategic plan committees have community members on those. And then our multicultural work that we've done for the last 2 years, having over 80 participants in that process. So many kudos went out on that. They also talked about a couple of areas that we can work on improvement. And so I shared those with you. We anticipate a final report to come out to get a preliminary report in the next 4 to 10 weeks and final approval sometime this summer, with a very detailed report of where we can go. My hope is that the board will use that as a springboard during our workshop in June that we typically do. That is a nice time to kind of kick that off for each of our buildings as we plan for school improvement in the future. Any questions I can answer for you this evening?
I had a question on the language arts curriculum that we're doing. Yes. Where the cost on the science curriculum that we have come in were exceptionally high. Are you seeing that same thing with the language arts?
It is.
A little more color on that.
It is very expensive that we're running into right now. Within the last 2 years, it used to be that if you bought a hardbound textbook, the publishers would very inexpensively give us the online text. for about a third of the cost or even less. At the current time, we're seeing that they are matching those prices, that the cost of an online textbook is the same as the actual textbook. And we have students who need both of those and really do have a better understanding and experience in the classroom if they have access to both those tools. So we are seeing that in the bids that we're having right now. Our one saving grace is that we have set aside ESSER funds to help us with that ELA adoption. We're starting in the sixth through eighth grade right now. Next year's work will be K through five, as well as high school 9-12. So a lot of work to do yet on that process.
And Dr. Hovey, I don't really have a question, but just a comment around the Cognia visit. I do really applaud you, Dr. Tindall, and others in the administration, as it seemed like you had prepared very well in partnership with them in designing that visit, and appreciated that preparation just from a board standpoint as well. And then I know that it's super preliminary in terms of the feedback that they provided, but at first blush, I felt it was a pretty good summary. I felt like they had gotten to know us well and the things that we do excellently, and even some of the long-term pieces around maximizing data for us to continue to improve around those areas that we already prioritize but can even get more excellent at. So we'll look forward to the final report later in the year, but I just wanted to say thank you to the administration, because we understand I've layered on top of your responsibilities to prepare well about that, and we do thank you for the work you did about that.
Absolutely, and I will compliment Dr. Tindall, because she has led this push and has been our liaison to Cognia over the last 2 years to get us ready for this visit. So great work all the way around, so.
Thank you, Dr. Hovey. That brings us to the superintendent's report. Highlighters, Dr. Hawk?
Yes, Karen Hawk, Superintendent of Schools. Oftentimes we talk about many of the educational opportunities that we have and the facilities that are built to accommodate those, but we also use those facilities for other things. Youth sports is a good example of that. This past week, 2 weekends ago, the Youth Soccer Association hosted a tournament. Over 100 different teams from across the state and other states, I'm assuming Iowa as well, that came here, as well as I think this past weekend we had quite a few teams in the area for baseball and softball. At this point in time, we have hired 59 new certificated staff for next year. 11 have transferred into different positions. On top of that, we will have hired, when we're all said and done with the openings, over 70 new staff. Now, to give you an example of what that would look like, we're looking at a small class in school in total as we hire and onboard these people. So it's very important that we continue our culture, very important that we onboard all of these people, including support staff, as we're looking at 35 to 40 new support staff as well. So our mentor-mentee program is important, and continuing to work with those people to make sure that what we do as a culture in Bennington stays as such. Any questions?
Thank you, Dr. Hawk. I know both committees have been doing work. Building and finances continue to kind of wrap up a first phase of this construction management and risk, which we handled in the last couple of board meetings, including a special meeting. I know the curriculum committee has been at work as well, and there are agenda items on those various topics through the meeting. But that said, curriculum committee, any comments you'd like to make at present?
We, of course, are bringing a good list for you from the proposals that the faculty of our school district brought before us. We have made our way through a great many of them. We're all but through. I think that we'll probably have one additional meeting to button up remaining proposals that we have not yet made decisions on. I do appreciate that the administration is very thorough around our budget, such that the things that we are approving, we can be sure align well with the increase in the budget that we expect, which is just over about $5.5 million. We did learn we're looking at about 13% growth. in our property valuations in our county. So we did account for that, meaning Dr. Hawk accounted for that in the amazing spreadsheet that we are provided every time we make these decisions. And I do appreciate that. This was a sort of fun meeting because we did have a great many additional new roles to support our educators in terms of our activities, as well as sort of after-school opportunities. Free and Fine Track, for example, we are including additional leaders for that team, which I think is really exciting. And to things expanding our district capacity, such as a payroll clerk. So there's quite the range of proposals that you'll see there, leaders. And we do have that proposal later in the agenda. The total about that. It's going to be about $500,000. Is that wrong? Am I just
tired?
$600,000, which is actually low compared to the others that we have brought to you. Believe it or not, but the list is there. It's rather lengthy, but I do think there's some really neat and important ads that are really close to kids' success. So that was a really good discussion.
Thank you. I think we're ready to proceed then with the construction report, Mr. Bird.
Hello. Hi, I'm Mike Bird with DLR Group, Construction Administration. Giving an update on the current projects that we have going on. Projects are going very well. Middle school and elementary actually are right on schedule to be finished per contract. Middle school right now is in the interior finish stage. They are doing painting, putting down flooring. Carpet has started in a lot of the classrooms. Basically hanging all the drywall and doing bulkhead work, and casework is being installed. They're working down in the gym right now, basically doing first coats and finishing up on all interior work. Elementary school is following up with that. They have all the windows in place. They have tile work going in the bathrooms, painting the walls, casework is going in. They are a little bit behind only because we have a lot of curtain wall that needs to go in to basically encapsulate the building so that they can finish a lot of work outside of the classroom. So,
could you explain curtain walls as people
start hanging? Curtain walls would be basically a large window, a large wall of glass.
Thank you.
So basically, you know, instead of just a window, it would be an entire wall going from top to bottom. So, my apologies. So they are planning on finishing up with all the paving on the outside, which will be all parking lot and the dry lanes here coming up shortly. They should be done by the end of the month, as well as the middle school. Right there, that is the locker room. They're getting ready to pour the benches for the lockers, painting of the gym in the middle school. And moving on to the middle school media center with the drywall, the tile work in the middle school, different colors in different areas, as well as one of the classrooms with the new carpet. Elementary school, that is the south area with the media center, front entry, brickwork, all the tile work is going into the bathrooms. So, different colors in the boys and girls restrooms, of course. And then, of course, the casework and the accent walls are being finished. Carpet has not started at the elementary school as of yet. Then you have the high school stadium. They're finishing up on some added work, which was the dugout areas and the plazas, and kind of finishing up with some random concrete work that had been were patching through there. So, as you can see, the weather has changed from last week to this week. So and the road work, this is actually from last week. They've actually been doing a lot in the last week or so. They poured 180 cubic yards, a lot of concrete on Friday. You might not know 180 is. And then, so they poured the entire road from east to west, and they've poured the roundabout from basically the conjunction point from the Woodney to 171st, and then they poured a large chunk of concrete today, moving south. So.
And I can't help it, but this was taken during the snowstorm the other day.
Yes, last year. In the 50-mile-an-hour wind. It was very nice to walk around.
Any questions for the board?
Mr. Burke, thank you.
Thank you.
Now we'll have this month's coordinator report. Just off nutrition services. Previewing the report, I'm anxious to have you cover the mind-boggling numbers in terms of meals served. So thanks.
Of course. Tracy Waxball, is it
up? Tracy Waxball, Nutrition Services Coordinator. So to start out, I wanted to share with you our vision statement. We understand that supporting students in the learning process is one of our major goal, and we feel that our vision statement represents that. Bennington Nutrition Services is dedicated to serving delicious and nutritious meals in a friendly environment that supports student learning and developing lifelong healthy lifestyles. This year, we were able to provide free meals to all students due to the USDA nationwide waivers. However, next year, we will not be able to continue that service. No longer will we be able to serve the free meals, and no longer will we be able to send home the snack lunches on early dismissal days. And then we will not be able to claim reimbursement at the higher summer food service rate that we were able to this year. And my next slide, I will kind of show you an example of those reimbursement rates. In addition, USDA is changing some of their standards or regulations. Effective July 1st, we can start offering flavored milk in the 1% low-fat variety. At least 80% of our weekly grains must be whole grain rich. And this year, we're not having any changes to the sodium restrictions, but next year, the sodium restrictions will become more strict, so they're going to decrease the milligrams of sodium per meal. These are those federal reimbursement rates I mentioned just a minute ago. As you can see, the summer food service program reimbursement rate is considerably higher than the lunch and breakfast program rates. So next year, when we reach to traditional luncheon program, those rates will be reimbursed based on their eligibility. So if they're a free student, if they're a reduced student, or if they're paid. Updated reimbursement rates will be released by the USDA during the summertime. We also receive a commodity entitlement from the USDA. This year, we received $123,630. We diverted $79,900 to the fresh fruit and vegetable program. So we were able to get fresh fruits and vegetables from a local distributor. And then that left us about $43,730 to use to order commodity foods through the Nebraska Department of DHHS. So we were able to get those monthly deliveries from them. Okay, this slide represents the number of reimbursable meals. And reimbursable meals means that we sold a meal to a student and it met all the requirements. So as you can see, breakfast, we've more than tripled our breakfast sales in the last couple of years since 2018. And then as you can see under the column that says 2021, those numbers are representative of March 31st. So when you look at the lunch reimbursable meals, we're clearly going to surpass the number of meals that we sold in 2021. In addition, you'll see an increase in a la carte sales because we were able to bring back those a la carte sales at our middle school and high school this year. Here are some statistics by school. On the left side of the screen, represents the free and reduced percentages. 10.7%, I just rounded up, but 10.7% of our children in the district are on free and reduced lunches. And you may ask, why would someone qualify or why would someone apply for free and reduced lunch when all the meals were free? The reason is because they were able to qualify for other student fees at a discounted price or transportation at a discounted price. You'll also notice that Heritage is the highest free and reduced percentage rate and Anchor Point is the lowest. On the right side of the screen represents our average daily participation. So that is a percentage of students that in that school building that are eating breakfast and lunch. Again, Heritage is the highest percentage of students eating lunch and breakfast, and then Bennington High School is the lowest percentages. So what we did this year is we did a comparison of 16 local school districts, and we wanted to see what the average meal price was, and this is in preparation to propose meal pricing for next school year. And the table to the left is breakfast, and you can see that we listed the average price in the metropolitan area, then our Bennington price, and then we subtracted the difference. And we did the same thing on the table on the right for lunch. And you can see that Bennington meal prices are consistently lower for student meals than the metropolitan area. These are our proposed meal prices for the 22-23 school year. For breakfast, we're recommending a price increase of 5 cents per meal. And for lunch, we're recommending an increase of 10 cents per meal. Please note that adult meal prices are subject to change because the minimum adult meal prices are released by the state agency during the summer, right about the time that they release those federal reimbursement rates. Nutrition services, we bid for our products and services. We ask our vendors to submit pricing to us in May for the following school year. We do that on an annual basis. We use Highland Dairy Foods for all of our milk products, Performance Food Service for all of our groceries and our paper supplies. Performance is also formerly known as Reinhardt Food Service. So when you see the large trucks pulling up to the schools, most of them all still have the Reinhardt logo. We use Rotellas for our bread products, and then we use Aramark for our dish towel cleaning services. Looking back over the year, I feel like we have accomplished a lot. A few of the highlights from this year has been, again, providing free meals to all of our students. Bringing back that a la carte sales at the middle school and high school. I believe those students really enjoy that. Purchasing new equipment for our schools due to increased student population and increased participation. And then also providing special meals for our students that have food allergies and/or disabilities. So looking forward to the future, we have a couple things lined up. Some of the highlights, again, we're looking at introducing some new digital menus. That way, students and families are able to access the menus on a mobile device. We're looking to improve serving lines at the high school in order to increase efficiency and serving times for all of our students at the high school. And then we also are looking at developing new training as we're growing and introducing and building new schools. We are working on developing a training program for new staff. I would be remiss if I did not mention the wonderful staff that work in nutrition services. They're very hardworking, dedicated team members, and especially the leadership of our head cooks in each of the buildings. The success of the program really goes to their credit. So I just wanted to make sure that I showed a picture of all the head cooks here and listed their names in the schools that they work at. So in summary, I just wanted to, let you guys know I love this place. I love this job. Truly love watching the kids come down, and they're super excited about what they're having for lunch and, socializing with their friends. And then it's just very rewarding to know that we're supporting them and, giving them what they need to get through their day and to be successful learners.
Any questions? Thank you.
Thank you. And there are no questions, but when I reflect on the number of changes that have come our way in the last couple of years, and the changes that will continue to come, I applaud the focus on mission and the work that that your whole team has done to do great work for students. So, thanks very much.
Thank you.
We have a lobbyist report this evening.
My apologies, we sure do. This is 57th day. They are running from 9 a.m. to midnight tonight. Our lobbyist, Ms. Plucker, is not able to attend because they're in session. Several bills have been debated today. The one, if you noticed, was the concealed carry, which took up a lot of their time today. It did fail, which I have a belief that will cause some pain with some other bills that are coming up later. But I will point out tax bill 873. This encompassed quite a few things, not only income tax, Social Security tax related to that income tax, but also property tax as well. It will be a few years before this starts to come into the picture of a school budget. So these things will not take effect, or they will be stair-stepped in one of the two as we look forward. So it should not affect the revenue of the district for this coming budget, but will have effects with property taxes and state aid as we move down the road. Any questions that I can answer from the lobbyist report?
No. Thank you, Dr. Hoff. Now our spotlight report for this month is multi-tiered systems of support.
Yes, you guys are stuck with me again, and another acronym, which is like just my world I live in. So MTSS, we started talking about this a few years ago, and then the pandemic kind of made us not have as much of a focus, but it's things that we've already been doing and that we continue to do. It's really the umbrella of everything Bennington Public Schools does to support social, emotional, behavioral, and academic needs for our students and staff. So what is it and how have we supported it so far? So it's typically, you'll see it in a pyramid format. So tier one, the core, what we're doing to address all students, all staff needs. And then tier two is the sum, and then the few. A lot of times we look at this as kind of placing kids into these buckets, though, and the real focus of it is how do we intensify instruction for students as they move in and out of these tiers, as it's a pretty fluid situation. So again, we've been doing these things. This is just ensuring intentionality, as MTSS is really the acronym that the state's using in Rule 51 and as they rewrite rules and regulations, and IDEA uses in our special ed regulations that we follow in the federal government. So that's why we're trying to be more intentional with this language. You see many areas on the right that have some tiered supports we put in place. So our district's very intentional with how we support our kids, and we have a lot in place. So we thank the district for that. So keys to MTSS. This is from the Nebraska MTSS guidance. These are the five areas. Strong core is the biggest part and probably the most important part to MTSS. Our district does really well, and I think that we are acknowledged across the state on the system that Dr. Hoagie and her team has in place when it comes to curriculum adoption and how we go about ensuring that it's a strong core. And then it comes to universal screening. We have things like our math data we look at, grade level benchmarking. Evidence-based is something that we're really good at the core level, and we're trying to get better at with our interventions to support students that do struggle, progress monitoring, problem solving, all things that we do. I like this quote. I actually just heard it a week ago at one of our trainings. This is not just about closing the achievement gap. It's about hitting the predictability. A lot of times we go in and we work with students that struggle, and we know they're going to struggle. We predict that, but then we don't plan for it. So kind of trying to end that predictability and plan ahead. We have two really big initiatives this year, and it really hit K-12. So K-8, we had social, emotional, behavior learning as our big focus, and then our high school was part of the secondary MTSS cohort. So with the SEBL support, so social emotional behavior learning with Nebraska MTSS, see, it's all the acronyms in the world. We had K-8 building teams, and we met four times during the first semester, and it was led by the Nebraska MTSS guidance and leaders. We had three ladies that helped lead our teams. We really focused on adult SEL that first semester because we know that if we're not healthy as adults, we can't help raise healthy children in our school system. And with the pandemic, we've really noticed that that's where the area we wanted to make sure that we were building up and filling the cups of our teachers and our parents and all of our staff. So we met four times for that. And then in January, we brought in Dr. Dominique Smith, and he gave a presentation to the entire staff on how all learning is socially emotional. We thought it was really motivating. It really affected PK through 12 staff. And then that afternoon, we broke into a workshop and really focused more on the student SEL with those groups that we created for semester. Finally, the process, which goes back to that strong core, is the SEL curriculum adoption. We've been working on this for a couple of years and put a lot of time and effort into it, and I'm sure we'll talk more about it at a later date, but we're looking at proposing a curriculum PK-12. Counselors have created scope and sequences along with it, and we'll be adding pieces and doing some TIP grant work this summer. The secondary MTSS cohort, we still know that SEBL is just as important at the high school, but the ESU has a cohort where it came along with a lot of districts throughout the metro area that we got to work along with, and then we got to create our own MTSS team, and our overall focus was really to reduce the amount of overall Fs. This is something we started prior, so it worked well with this. We collected data as we looked over the last year from 2020. We had, I think, around 6% of our students had an F at the end of first semester. This last year, we were down 3.5%. So we're seeing good things happen with the interventions they put in place, the freshman success team, and so on. As we move forward, though, we're looking at how can we add intervention time into the high school? Right now, we have it at elementary, we have it at middle school, but what are we doing to support high school and all students? So there's different things bouncing around. Right now, we have our homeroom scheduled, but it's not every week. Could we go to that weekly and have some kind of intervention block built in? Looking at the master schedule, we keep learning that that's the most important piece. Our high school is wonderful. So just continuing to reflect and see what we can do to make it more effective. And we created a walkthrough observation for administrators to target differentiation and determine if we're finding any links between strategies we're seeing in classrooms and Fs, whether they're higher amount of students with Fs or a lower amount, if there's anything we're seeing with professional development we can help. Planning forward, we're going to continue with MTSS SEBL. We have another meeting this year to really try to plan out a whole year in advance. This year we met several times, and I think it was great at the time, but I think that they built their capacity, so trying to be effective and efficient for next year. The secondary cohorts, we're going to continue into a year two. We have another meeting in June, and then next year we'll have trainings with the ESU as well and the coach assigned. Problem-solving teams, we continue to reflect on this, see how we can better support staff, provide interventions, look at student risk levels, and then MTSS district-wide, just trying to continue to update. We have a staff MTSS website with interventions, processes in place, and just training staff on that level of interventions and then using this language to get a little more consistent. This is another quote from the Nebraska MTSS site. We stop asking if students are responding, and start asking if our current system is working for all students. And that's kind of the point of MTSS. We're growing fast, we need systems, and this helps us just be intentional with that. Any questions? I know I talk fast.
No questions. Again, I was struck by, the breadth and the depth of strategies to support students in their learning, social, behavioral. When they work well, you maybe kind of don't notice or understand how many there are. So appreciate the good and continuing work on that front. I believe last but certainly not least is an update on strategic planning area number 3. On community collaboration.
All right, good evening.
Mr. President, before, just a transition and an announcement.
I know Mr. Boyce will be speaking first, but Mr. Lambert will be speaking as well. We did have in the consent agenda that we had two transitions for administrators. One of those, and congratulations to Dr. Blumenkamp, he will be moving to assistant superintendent next year in district operations. The other one will be a presenter here in just a little bit, Mr. Greg Lamberty, who will be named the high school principal. And congratulations to both of those. Mr. Boyce?
I feel the excitement coming on. I've got to stand on this side. Chad Boyce, I'm the principal at Anchor Point Elementary, and this is Greg Lamberty. He'll be the new principal at high school. And we also have Mr. Upman that'll join us here. So, community collaboration. We are strategic goal number 3, and we really focus on the collaboration with the community. There's our goal. We want to increase that collaboration. We've done a lot over the last 7 to 8 years. We're really proud of kind of where we're at and where we're going next. Mr. Upman's going to kind of talk about our latest update, which is our website.
So I kind of got the little brother bring along as we went to the website here. If you haven't had a chance, the website was completely redesigned. This was a very thoughtful process as we went through it. We looked at how our constituents were coming into it and found over 85% of our people were coming on mobile devices. So we, one of our key goals was to make sure it was mobile friendly, that was responsive, so it didn't matter if it was a cell phone, an iPad, a computer. It worked and looked the same no matter where you were coming from. Sorry. As we've gone through, we built a uniform feel throughout the website, but each school will now have its own webpage. Calendars are tied to those schools. They have controls over there. It should give us a much easier way to disperse the information that our communities want. So calendars will be different for each one. News stories are different for each one. Really highlighting what's going on in those schools as we continue to grow.
Right, and one thing that Mr. Uckman did mention is the responsiveness. So many of our, when we first built our website years ago, we weren't really worried about what it looked like on a cell phone. The cell phones were just kind of coming along. Now nobody looks at it really on a computer, and everybody wants it to be responsive to a cell phone. The other nice thing that with this website is it kind of triangulates with our district app that we developed last year and with our school messaging system. So they all triangulate, they all come from the same system, so they kind of can communicate better. And I do want to say thank you to all of our building webmasters, and Connie and Bosch, who's our like the highest of high webmasters, whatever that would be called.
Good evening. I got the last slide, which is just what are our next steps and where are we headed. We thought we would take this opportunity to stake claim to the district's communications coordinator, which is currently being advertised, and feel that person would be a great fit for strategic planning goal number 3, and incorporate them into, you know, all of our objectives with helping us communicate a consistent message throughout the district and getting them involved in the oversight of making sure our community knows what's going on and what we're trying to do within our schools. Thank you.
Any questions?
I don't have any questions, but I do want to say thank you for the thoughtfulness and the redesign, and particularly that we have websites unique to each school. Really critical change, and glad that was part of it. So thanks for that.
Well, and like I said, I do want to say thank you to all the webmasters, because there has been hours and hours of work that have gone into that. And Mr. Upman has done a great job of helping us tech illiterates, like Mr. Lamberty and I speak, like we at least know what we're talking about with the professionals that are not just doing this. So it's a team effort. Team effort.
Thank you. Now we'll move from our reports to unfinished business, the first of which are some construction change orders. Dr. Pock, could you give us some background on those change orders?
Correct. We do have 3 change orders. One is simply pain. You'll see it with road contractor making change order in that regard, fixing of the pipe, but there is one in the middle school that has transitioned to Bennington Elementary number 5. So as you see, a cost here and a deduct there. So they are change orders. By policy, they have to be approved. So we do have a zero in terms of the dollar amount, but are approving the cost in one and a deduct in the other.
I move to approve all items listed for construction, ES number 5, for the 171st and Whitney Road project change orders, which equates to no total cost increases. Elementary number 5, CCR number 15, and that 171st Whitney Road. I'll second.
Thank you, Valerie, and a second by Kara. This is a rare opportunity to approve nothing and get something. So, any discussion? Jody, please call the roll.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next, we have consideration of the personnel and curriculum proposals from the curriculum committee.
Yes, Dr. Hoagie was kind enough to take a lot of the notes out and provide you just the spreadsheet for approval to see.
I move to accept the recommendations of the Curriculum and Americanism Committee and the administration for the 2022-23 curriculum and personnel modifications and additions as outlined in the report dated March 30th and pending the 22-23 budget approval.
I'll second.
Thank you, Valerie, and again, a second by Kara. Any further discussion on this topic? Hearing none, Jody, please call the roll.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Motion carries. I do want to take the opportunity to thank the curriculum committee for their work in a very busy year, understanding that it may not quite yet be finished. Next, we'll move to consideration of modifications to school calendars for this year and for next year, namely setting an end date for this academic year and approving a calendar for next year. Dr. Hawk?
Yes, Mr. President, you are correct. We're looking to set the end date for Tuesday. We did have two early or late releases, and we had one complete day that we missed. The administration is not recommending at this point in time to make those up. As you can see in this section here, that we do have enough hours of attendance. We're in compliance. Therefore, the last school day will be Tuesday, I believe it is May 24th. And your motion is for that. And then if you'd like, I can speak to the other after this motion, or would you like me to speak to both?
You have the floor, please continue.
We are also looking to add the 14 early dismissal days. Many of these early dismissal days are for professional development. However, the beginning of school, the end of school, and the last day before winter break are also early release days. So in addition to those, there are 11 others for professional development. We have added those into the calendar for next year. And what we've heard is many people appreciate that so they can schedule appointments during those early release days. So we have both motions before you this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Hawk. And because there are two different calendars, I think it is appropriate that we do have two different motions. So I would entertain one regarding the end date for this academic year.
I so move to approve the revised 21-22 calendar with a starting date of August 18, 21, and the end of the school year scheduled for May 24, 22.
Thank you, Tim.
Second.
And a second for Valerie. Any discussion or questions on this motion? Jody, please call the roll.
Mark?
Yes.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Motion carries. And I move to approve the revised 2022-23 school calendar with an early release date starting on August 17, 2022, including 176 student days and 186 contract days.
Second.
Thank you, Tim. Is there a discussion on this motion?
Mr. President, just a note, there will not be any Friday notes this week because of the shortening, but we will make sure to communicate that there are calendar changes in the next Friday notes. We ask the buildings to do the same as we move forward.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Joe, you please call the roll.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Martin?
Yes. Motion carries. And now proceeding to new business, our first item is setting hot lunch prices and breakfast prices for the 2022-23 year. Dr. Hawk?
Yes, as has been discussed by the Coordinator of Nutritional Services, Tracy Watson-Ball, we do have a motion before you, which does raise the prices anywhere from 5 cents to 10 cents. I believe it's been discussed quite bit in the presentation. Are there any questions that either the coordinator or I could answer before you look at the motion?
Are my questions appropriate now or after the motion is
brought? That would be fine.
I'm curious about other districts and the extent to which you've heard whether they're also increasing prices. I'm mindful that we've had a very unusual couple of years and that the federal government has provided the means for us to have no cost lunch for our families. So I'm just curious about whether we received any information or what it looks like. And my second follow-up is around our budget and whether anticipated changes in the lunch and breakfast would be. I mean, I know that's kind of hard. We're like crystal ball about that, but I am just mindful of that big change for families after the last couple of years.
So the first question was both A and B. The answer to, we do not have a lot of information as to others at this point in time. The B to that is not necessarily something you ask, but there are a floor that is provided by the federal and state government as to what you do have to charge. It was mentioned a little bit that those prices come out in the summer. So we have always been very close to that, and we anticipate that that's going to go up. The second is the expenses. Keep in mind that we did raise personnel costs quite a bit in this area, and we are seeing double-digit costs in terms of expenses related to this. The other side of this is the reimbursement. There's really three revenue streams: the reimbursable, the commodities, and one that we've been absent, that is the per pay cost. The reimbursable has been extremely high over the last couple of years. As you saw in the presentation, that's going to drop. So it's hard to predict, but one of the things that is a positive for Bennington is the participation. And as long as we keep that participation in that 65% lunch above what it is for breakfast at this point in time, we're not looking to make money. Simply, we're trying to anticipate what those costs are going to be and be a smidge in the black as we move forward. It is always a little bit of an estimating game to get to those costs. We can determine what those costs are going to be in the next couple of months as other districts come out and determine their prices. Keep in mind, one of the larger ones, Omaha Public Schools, has already come out and said they're going to use some of their ESSER monies to continue the free meals as they move forward. So that's a difficult thing to combat against as we move forward.
Appreciate that. And I think I saw, and appreciate the data that Ms. Wasbaum provided around the average of area districts. And it looks to be that this increase, potential increase, would then kind of put us on par with what those, and I assume that, those prices were pre last couple of years, sort of like ours. I'm assuming that's
that would be a correct assumption, as the the United States was in that category.
Thank you so much. I'm glad.
I move to set 2022-23 prices for student and adult hot lunch and breakfast as presented, in particular, a 10-cent increase in elementary, middle school, high school, and adult lunches, and a 5-cent increase in elementary, middle school, high school, and adult breakfast.
I'll second.
Thank you, Carolyn. Any further discussion? Jody, please call the roll.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes. Motion carries. The next item on our agenda is a discussion related to future district capital improvements, meaning that the board and the administration have been in discussion for quite a while regarding facility needs for the district, including a new high school, which we are well into the process of planning for, as well as another elementary school on the horizon as well, following the completion of Stratford Elementary. Usually, when we're considering a bond, we also evaluate other district needs for facilities, either due to aging equipment, building replacement, or those things that the community might be interested in the district adding to its facilities for the benefit of our students and the community. So with that in mind, the intention of the district has been to conduct a survey in the community to understand what the priority of those various needs would be. But in order to conduct that survey, we need to bring something to them. And so the board needs to go through the work of defining what it would like to ask the community about. I would propose that we ask the administration to gather a list of those things that it has received feedback on from the community and the needs that it sees in facilities around the district. And then this board will have a special meeting in a couple of weeks to review that information and then proceed how best to proceed with the survey. So Dr. Hawk, we've discussed that a little bit. Anything you would add to this?
Well, I think you've done a very good job of describing that. You do not need a motion to set a special meeting. You simply put a notice in the paper to do so. Jody, I would be willing to do that, obviously, soon. And the administration would be tasked with bringing you not only a list, but some rationale that goes along with that. At this point in time, the board is not being asked to define that list, but simply to understand that list. And as Dr. Meyer, or, well, I wish another degree, Mr. Myers has suggested that we go out to survey and ask our community, you know, number one, if these things are necessary, would you consider them? Or number two, do you understand what the Board of Education is asking at this point in time? So we hope to bring that information to you.
Very good. I also would suggest it's appropriate as the administration is preparing its list. Certainly, I would, the community will have an opportunity to respond through the survey. But if anybody desires to express their thoughts to the administration or to the board on what we might consider, we would certainly love to hear that as we go through a thoughtful process on how to prioritize these items for the community. So, any other thoughts, requests? Then we'll move to administrative compensation for the 2022-23 school year. So again, Building and Finance Committee has been working over the last couple of months with administration to review a number of compensation issues, I would say, related to administration, which includes administrators moving to new roles, different responsibilities in certain administrative roles, and the like. Dr. Hawkins, you summarize the recommendations for admin compensation.
Absolutely. As we discussed this evening, that there are, we did make an announcement that two people are moving positions. There are two others that will be moving from assistant to principalship. We did take in consideration, the Building and Finance had a discussion about large increases because they are taking on more responsibilities. And thus, those four positions are not in the average that is labeled up there, anywhere from 3.5 to 5.9. Some of those positions, because of more responsibilities and more time, are double digit. Therefore, those that are still remaining in a similar position are a part of the average, and that average is 4.09. That is well under the support staff and under the certificated staff that has been approved by the board in the past. The salaries are there, and a motion is before the board.
Thank you. I would also remind the board that not included in consideration of administrative compensation is superintendent compensation or contracting, which is addressed in by separate board action. That I would move to approve the 2022-23 salary and benefit proposal for administrators as presented.
Second.
Thank you, Allison. Questions or discussion? Jody, please call the roll.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes. Motion carries. Next item of new business is consideration of the summer band program stipend. This is a an annual event program that we've that the band director has had every year. Dr. Hawk, additional comments?
No, I think you stated it right. It is an annual. It is a requirement of use of the fees and an additional pay for an employee. As you can see, this would be a new band director, and I think it's a great start for a new person prior to the season to get to know the student body.
Thank you.
I move to approve the recommended lesson structure and pay for a summer band program. Payment not to exceed $4,000 to be paid to Ted Cody on or before August 15, 2022.
Second.
Moved by Valerie and seconded by Allison. Any discussion? Jody, please call the roll.
Allison?
Yes.
Excuse me. Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Motion carries. In a similar vein, we have a stipend for summer voice lessons. Dr. Hawk, any additional color on this?
None, sir.
Motion is before the board.
I move to approve the recommended lesson structure and pay for summer vocal program with payment not to exceed $1,800 to be paid to Mr. Tybinski on or before August 15, 2022.
Second.
Moved by Valerie and seconded by Kara. Any further discussion? Jody, please call the roll.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next, we will review our certified staff report. Dr. Hawk.
Yes. Annually, the board around the month of April does approve a list of certificated staff for continuing contracts the next year. Not done so by April 15th in statute, that is by law, they would be continuing contracts. So an employee with 3 years or less must be notified by March 15th if they're not offered a contract for the following year. And anybody with 4 years or more, same on April 15th. The board does approve this, so that these would be continued contracts for certificate of staff for the 22-23 school year.
Thank you, Dr. Hoff.
I move to approve the continuing contracts of the certificated teachers and administrators as presented and recommended by the administration.
Second.
Moved by Kara, seconded by Valerie. Any discussion? Jody, please call the roll.
Valerie?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
Kara?
Yes.
Motion carries. And now we'll cover a couple of actions related to construction easements and right-of-way dedication. Dr. Hawk?
Yes, if the board remembers at the last special meeting in March that we did an easement for 168th Street, if you haven't traveled down 168th Street in the last 6 hours, it is now closed from military to state. It should open up as scheduled before the start of school. This is 171st Street along Military. Military Road will need a turning lane to go into 171st Street or access school. The first one is for a construction easement, i.e. they can park equipment and unload, load supplies or parts that will go for that road on the property of the school.
Thank you, Dr. Hawk. I move that the Board of Education of this school district should and does hereby authorize and approve temporary construction easement by and between Douglas County, Nebraska and this school district related to certain roadway improvements along Military Road near 171st Street, and that the board hereby approves and adopts the attached resolution.
Second.
Thank you, Tim. Discussion regarding this easement. Jody, please call the roll.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes. And also a discussion regarding right-of-way.
Correct. Because there's a turning lane, there is need for additional land or right-of-way easements between the county and the school district. This allows for the widening of that road and the widening of those right-of-way documents that are necessary for that turning lane.
I move the Board of Education of this school district should and does hereby authorize and approve the right-of-way warranty deed dedication to Douglas County, Nebraska relating to certain roadway and other improvements along Military Road near 171st Street, and that the board hereby approves and adopts the attached resolution.
Second.
Thank you, Allison. A clarification question. How far, between Military and state, approximately, where is the widening? Is it all the way to Military, all the way to state, somewhere in between?
No, the right-of-way will be around Military.
Okay.
So it is basically the southern ditch of Military to the school property. And there is a map that is attached, which will show you what that right-of-way is.
Any other questions? Are you wanting to look at the map, people?
Yeah, I didn't see the map, but...
Would you mind pulling that up, Dr. Hawk?
Do you have it?
You're seeing right there. So there is 171st, which would be the new road. And there's the bend in Military, if you will. Yeah, if you really want it, there's the legal description.
The map will be fine. Picture is worth all of those words.
So, yes.
Are there any further questions or discussion? Jody, please call the roll.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes. Our last item on our agenda this evening is an executive session, and when we return from executive session, there will not be any further business. So before we part ways, I did want to thank students in particular for attending this evening. It is the nicest evening in the last 4 weeks, and that you would choose to spend it in a boardroom, I appreciate it. So we do intend to go into executive session for purposes of discussing the superintendent contract. So I move that the board do that at 7:10 for the purpose of strategy session with respect to the superintendent contract, as an executive session is clearly necessary for the protection of public interest.
Second.
Thank you, Valerie. As I mentioned, the board does not intend to take any action following executive sessions. Jody, please call the roll.
Kara?
Yes.
Valerie?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes. Again, thank you all.